Hello everyone, now we'll discuss another application of at-risk software, that is on insurance industry. So let's see one more application on insurance domain, how this software can help you using Monte Carlo simulation. You can take a better decision and it could be a better recommendation to that particular insurance industry, how they can manage their risk and they can take a strategical decision making. Let's see how it works. So here you can see that software has come, and now we'll illustrate this application. Look at the data. We have collected this particular data of this example from their website. Let's see. So here it's a, you know, insurance claim related problem. Suppose you have a data of last 20 years on three different type of claim. One is the auto claim, another is the general liability, and the third one is the worker compensation. So here for auto claim, you have per year how many number of claim were been generated, that's been mentioned here. So 845 means number of auto claim for the year one, or say last year. Then 927 means number of auto claim for the next year, immediate preceding year. So this way you have total 20 years number of auto claim. And then also you have a data of general liability of last 20 years and worker compensation. And also you have, say, for each category of claim, last 1 year, like this year, say, let me, you know, make it color, you'll be able to understand. For last 1 year, you have, say, you know, for auto claim, you have 845 number of auto claim, and here you have the amount of auto claim, you can see here. Here you can see total 845 number of, the amount of claim are been given for each particular claim. So here you can see, select the entire data, here you can see total 845 number of claims are there, and for each claim how much amount of money are been asked or been disbursed, that also for insurance claim in the auto segment are been also given here. So for only 1 year data are been given to you, so 845 sample is sufficient. We can get a guess that, you know, what could be the future amount of claim on an average for that particular segment of auto claim. Similarly, for general liability, you have in first year 207 claim. So that data are been given, amount of claim are also been given, right? Here you can see, here. Similarly, so you can see total 207 claims are, amount of claim are given, various amount of claim are given. Similarly, for worker compensation, amount per person of, or say per worker compensation amount are been also given as 108 claim are concerned. So this 1 year data of amount of claim are given, and total 20 years data of number of claim are also given. So that means in case on an average for next year, if you do a calculation, the what could be the say number of amount of auto claim, you have to multiply the average of that amount and say 845. So this is a common sense, but what we are going to do now, let's see. First, here you can see the average of number of auto claim we have calculated. In last 20 years, the total claim are been mentioned, so we have taken the average of them, and also we have calculated, here you can see the average of the claim and the standard deviation of the data we have noted down, and the mean of the data and the max of the data. The upper bound, lower bound have also been calculated. Similarly, for general liability, we can see the mean data, and for worker compensation. So here you can understand that what type of distribution it is following. So we can also calculate that. You can select the data, and you can go to at risk, and you can see, you know, distribution fitting. So you can see it is triangular distribution, it is following triangular distribution. So we'll see that later. So this data, number of auto claim are following one-sided triangular distribution. Fine, we'll see that. Similarly, for other type of claim also you can calculate what type of distribution it is following. Now for number of amount of claim also we have calculated the mean data, right? The average of the mean data, the standard deviation of the data, the amount of claim, And mean, max, all these 5th percentile, 95th percentiles, we have also calculated 90% confidence interval. You can also calculate based on the data, this particular software. So suppose this data you have. Just for the sake of information, let me keep this color, this particular cell with yellow color, and say this one. This is the average data, right? So what you can do in general, people can do, people can calculate the average prediction could be, say, next year, the amount could be this multiplied by this one, right? This could be the general prediction that this much of amount you should keep, allocate for, you know, auto claim for the next year. This is the expected prediction, because expected amount of, say, amount of claim per person are being averaged here it is, 3409. So in terms of, say, money, rupees, thousands, or say dollar, whatever. And also the on an average, the number of auto claim are being also calculated. So you can multiply that, you may calculate the expected prediction of your total amount of auto claim. Similarly, you can calculate for general liability as well as the worker compensation. This is the common sense people can calculate, common way people can calculate. But here we are not going to do that. What we will do? We will do some risk analytics here. So here you can see, this is what number of claim which are now following triangular distribution. Suppose here we have defined uniform distribution. For the sake of illustration, I have mentioned, but it is following triangular distribution. And also type of claim, we have used triangular distribution. You can check their data also, whether it is following triangular distribution or not. You can check that also. But suppose we have assumed it, you know, come here, you can see defined distribution fitted. Here you can see it is following some beta general distribution, not a matter. So we can consider them also beta general distribution. Here you can see now it is, earlier you have considered as a triangular distribution, now you have replaced it as a beta general distribution. This one I have defined a uniform distribution, but if you wish, you can change this as triangular distribution. As per the data pattern, you can define that also. Select the data and define distribution, fit it, go to new, and then just select that particular model sheet and select this particular cell and write to cell and just select this particular cell. Done. So now it has been changed now. Now this data, earlier we have considered uniform and triangular. Now this is triangular and this one is some other distribution, beta general. As per the data pattern, we have selected it. Similarly, general liability also you can calculate. I have kept uniform, risk uniform, and the risk triangular. You can change based on the pattern of the data. You can check and you can do it. I will illustrate only the auto part, right? Auto case. So now suppose these two data we have. This data is nothing but this particular representative of the data which is following triangular distribution, and this data, which one, this particular type of claim are now following some beta distribution which are been generated from this particular 845 sample. So now you have these two. Now here we have multiplied. You can see the multiplication. Simple multiplication you can do, which I have shown you here. Suppose if you do the simple multiplication here, for your information, let me do it here, simple multiplication. So if you do the simple multiplication, this, even in the previous sheet I have shown you that if you take the expected value and if you do a multiplication, what you will get? Here I have mentioned that part. Look at here. This you will get simple multiplication of these two set, right? So here it is nothing but expected, you know, auto claim for the next year, amount of auto claim, right? So here you can see that this is nothing but the average of the data. But now if you come to the model, here you can see same multiplication I have done, but here now that number of claim and the amount of claim are been multiplied through random sample. So in every simulation, now you will be generating one sample of auto claim and the amount of auto claim. So you will multiply them, and you will, if you generate thousands of simulations, you will be able to get thousands of output of amount of auto claim. So in the previous case, you had only one average value here, this one. But here now you are generating random sample. So what we are getting? Let's generate it. So we have selected a, you know, only auto case I am explaining. Similarly, you can take the total sum of allocation for the insurance industry, whether it can be an example of say ICICI Lombard or, you know, HDFC, AMC, wherever you can think on that. SBI insurance, so you know, you can LIC also, you can think on these examples. So here suppose I am focusing only on the auto case. So now here it's your risk output. If you run it, say instead of 100 sample, let us make it 1000 sample. We'll run this one. So you can observe that the output case, so here our output results, here you can see the mean is around 33 lakhs, right, on an average. And the standard deviation is almost 14 lakhs, 13.9792 lakhs, note down. So mean is almost 33 lakhs and, you know, standard deviation is almost 14 lakhs, note down it. You can see mean and say standard deviation, right. So what is the mean for this particular data? Select it. We have already run the result. So here almost how much? 33.10 lakh and standard deviation is 13.92. So suppose mean is 33.1 lakh and standard deviation is almost 13.92 lakh. Variation, imagine, even only for auto claim. Forget about the total, grand total. You can do that. You can drag it and you can do it. Just auto claim I am sharing with you. So you can see the data variation, because every time you are generating and the entire sample of 1000 data confidence interval, you can also, you know, like the previous illustration, you can also, you know, get to know. Now what I am going to do here, what we have done, we have generated one claim of auto for a particular year and say, you know, amount of claim. The mistake that we have done here is that, let me keep it in the right hand side. The mistake that we have done here is that for every simulation, suppose we have done 1000 simulation, right? For every simulation, what mistakes we have got here is that, or we have done it, committed here is that, suppose if you generate say 700 number of claim, suppose in a iteration you have generated 700 number of claim, right? And then you have generated suppose 3410, say 3500. These are the thumbnail kind of things, some of the maybe one of the sample iteration you found, but it is not the average, right? So suppose now if you come here, suppose in a particular iteration of your 1000 simulation, suppose you have generated 700 number of claim. It should not be dollar, it's a 700 number of claim, right? And amount of claim, suppose, it's coming out to be in a particular simulation 3500. Then what happened? You have multiplied this value 700 multiplied by 3500. So this way you are doing your total claim, right? Total amount of claim. So what mistake you are doing here is that you are actually considering that, or you are assuming that every people of 700 claim or every auto claim, you will have the same amount of claim. Every person will come for the auto claim and they will claim 3500, and that simulation you have generated here, which is incorrect, right? For every person, the amount of claim should also change, but that consideration you are not including in your simulation. What we'll do, we'll use a, you know, comment here, like, you know, some, you know, formula here that is called risk compound. And in that case, they will do another one more simulation inside the simulation. That means when you generate say, you know, 700 number of auto claim, or say, you know, 800 or whatever, in every simulation you will change that, maybe 900, 700, every simulation, every iteration you are doing it. So suppose you have generated 700 number of auto claim. So for that, when you run the second claim, the second cell like this one from your beta distribution, so in that case your amount of claim will also vary for each 700 people or 700 claim. So in that case you might say that perhaps variation will be high. No, variation will come down, because you are trying to capture the reality, practical cases. So if you do that through this risk compound formula, look at here, risk compound, just I have multiplied and through the risk compound formula. And now if I run this, yeah, it is taking 1000 simulation. And if you run this, you will see the variation. Look at the outcome for auto claim only, the variation. What is the mean? Mean is almost 33.50, almost same 33.50. You can see earlier it was 33.10 lakhs, here it is 33.50, almost same. But look at the standard deviation. Standard deviation has come down 3.49 only. Let me write down here. 3.49 lakh of standard deviation. And imagine this, the reduction in your confidence interval that you are getting from this particular risk analytics version of insurance claim. And here you can see the variation in the previous case, even if you consider the simulation and the random scenario of the practical aspects, but still you are committing a mistake. What mistake? That for every claim you are multiplying, the amount of claim should be same for that entire year, but that should not be the same. In practice, your amount of claim should vary from person to person. So therefore, if you include that through risk compound formula, here you can see your, on an average, the mean will same, mean of amount, total amount of claim for the auto industry will be the same for auto insurance. But standard deviation is reducing. Look at here, only 3.5 lakhs, but earlier almost 14 lakhs. So this much of variation, if you reduce, imagine that your confidence interval will also increase also. 90% confidence interval, if you see, 28.87 and 39.99. So this much, you know, reduction you are able to do in reducing your confidence interval. As well as you can see your lower bound, here how much is lower bound? 28 lakhs, and upper bound is how much? It's almost, you know, 44. If you come here, the basic multiplication with different random input, and here you can see 6 lakhs, lower, as low as it can go to 6 lakhs, and as much as it can go up to 85 lakhs. So variation is high, and the lower bound, upper bound is also high, and your confidence interval also 90%. You can see 90% confidence interval here, you can see. And here you can see 1.27 to 6 lakhs only, right? Maybe, you know, it's not 6, it could be, you know, probably 60. It could be 60. We can check that. So here you can see the differences in your outcome analysis. But I can run this again. Let me close it. Yeah, we are generating 1000 simulation. Perhaps earlier on it was 100 simulation, but now we are generating 1000 simulations. For us, we will get a better insights. Here, 13.41. So it was 13.41. You can see, right? And on an average, mean is same. And here you can see the lower bound, like, you know, to some extent, it's like, you know, 7 lakhs, and upper bound is 78 lakhs. And 90% confidence interval also, you can see around 56 lakhs, 13 lakhs to 56 lakhs. 13 lakhs to 56 lakhs, 90% confidence interval. But if you use the risk compound, where, you know, in every simulation, every iteration of your simulation, you are changing the amount of claim from each person of claim, or each amount of, you know, each candidate of auto claim. So in that case, you can see your variation also. It is had gone up to 27 lakhs and 43, and 90% confidence interval, see, 29 to 40 just. So the confidence interval also been reduced, as well as the reduced standard deviation. So this kind of analysis you will be able to do, and you can accordingly you can plan of your, like, an allocation of fund for the insurance industry, whether auto, general liability, or worker compensation, or in overall fund allocation for the next year. That prediction you are able to do well in advance with a better, you know, understanding of that particular analytics aspects of insurance claim. So now this is the example that I have discussed about insurance claim part. Now we'll discuss the example of product mix with uncertainty. And this type of problem, it's an optimization problem under uncertainty. This type of problem are very popular in manufacturing sector, or say, you know, inventory planning segment, or say production planning domain. So let's see one application of that in production planning or manufacturing sector, how that simulation based risk analytics can help you in taking a better decision. Here, you know, so many data are there, but I will summarize the information that what aspects we are going to cover here. So that I will explain so that you can understand by seeing the lecture, or you can practice by taking the sample data at your home by downloading the trial version of this particular software. Here you can see some, you know, unit cost of the production are been given, say, you know, labor cost, assembly line cost, testing line, like manufacturing line 1, manufacturing line, here we call it is a testing line 1 and testing line 2. And there are, you know, this, if you read this particular problem statement, I think they need to produce some, you know, 5 type of laptop or electronic devices. Say, think about the example of, say, Dixon technology, say. Suppose here you have 5 products, say 5 cell phone Dixon technology is going to produce for the next month, say. And the demand for that particular, or say, order flow for that particular type of cell phone are been given here, right? Say 4 type of cell phone and it's been given, and the production line, so the input data sets are been given here, say, you know, for all 5 type of cell phone, say labor cost, labor hour, right, the raw material requirement or the resource requirement, labor hour for assembly, labor hour for line 1, line 2, production plan 1, production line 1, production line 2, and the cost of component parts, selling price, if Dixon sell the product to the clients, how much profit they will get, the revenue they will get, that is also been given, and the overhead cost if there is excess inventory. Suppose whatever example you can see, you know, whether it's electronics product or any other example also, you can see if there is excess inventory, you might have to pay some, you know, holding cost, etc. You can, or, you know, discount price, you can mention that also. And demand and the, you know, production quantity. Here we have mentioned the production quantity. Initially, we'll assume it, say, you know, initial case, right, 100. Then we'll run it. This you can assume 0 also. Suppose we are assuming the initial assumption of your production quantity for each type of product, suppose 100, 100, 100, and this is the total production, say, but effectively you don't know what will be the final production based on the demand, cost, etc. And here you can see the number of sold. Based on this sum, you can calculate your number of sold product for 2 type of product and leftover inventory, excess inventory, and the, you know, the condition, the assembly line condition. Here you can see assembly line, the total used are been calculated like this, sum product of this and the assembly time, total production and the assembly time. Similarly, you can calculate the testing line 1. Here you can see that line 1 and the, you know, the amount of hour, you multiply the quantity and the time required for the production. And testing line 2, you can see, look at the amount produced, row number 24, and the time required. So this you have availability, right? You have a limit. So here you can see you have a assembly line budget, or say, you know, total available time for the month, and similarly manufacturing line 1, manufacturing line 2, testing line 1, testing line 1, and testing line 2, whatever you want, right? This is a sample example. You can relate to any other practical example, but a sample illustration I am trying to show you. So these are the limit. So what you have calculated now? Let's see now. You have your total revenue. You can multiply the number of sold and the selling price, right? You can check the selling price. You can multiply that. Similarly, you can subtract the entire all the cost. Look at the cost, total unfilled cost, unmet demand cost, like penalty cost, testing line 1 cost, quantity product produced, into multiply the time and the corresponding cost, you can see, right? Same way you can calculate all the other cost, and if you subtract that from your revenue, you will get your total profit for model 1, say cell phone 1, and you can calculate your total profit here, right? Sum and the risk output, you have to make it so that you can get the output under risk environment. Now here what we have done, sample illustration, you can increase more information, more uncertainty to the data. So here we have assumed that demand for each product are following triangular distribution. They are not fixed. You don't know what could be the sale, what could be a variation in the demand, that you don't know. And based on the past data, you have assumed that they follow triangular distribution. So you have considered only one type of uncertainty, that is the sales uncertainty, or say you can say the demand for the product are been changed. Because from the past data, you have calculated your demand, but you don't know what could be the future demand. Remember, this is a practical problem I am talking about. I have given example of Dixon. Probably you can relate it to the, you know, any niche vendor problem. You can relate it to any production planning problem or any other, you know, real life example, where you can set this product mix problem of manufacturing or production planning, and you can solve your practical example. And now here, what is the objective now? The objective is maximize your profit. Objective is to maximize the profit subject to the restrictions. Subject to these restrictions, here I have put only the assembly line restrictions and the testing line 1 and testing line 2 restrictions. But you can add more, like, you know, budget restriction, your say credit card restrictions, your investment restriction, you can say space restriction, machine utilization restrictions, many other restrictions you can put, and you can actually solve this problem. This, and based on what? Based on this production quantity. This production quantity could be 0 also initially. It could be say 200 also, you don't know. Initially you are assuming it, but software will, the Excel solver will optimize this particular, you know, production quantity. Subject to that, you have a conditions, restrictions here. Subject to the restrictions, here I have kept only couple of restrictions, but in practical problem you might have a many more restrictions, right? and you have to maximize your revenue. Sometimes you may need to minimize your manufacturing cost or production planning cost or inventory cost or warehousing cost, or you may need to maximize your supply chain profit. So depending on the problem statement, your scenario will change. But overall, the conditional restriction of optimization, here we are focusing on the linear optimization. You can extend that concept to the non-linear optimization also. But this linear optimization will come into the picture, and you have to optimize the production total profit subject to the maximum production with limited expenditure or your available resources. So this type of problem, we call it is a maximization problem. We call it is optimization problem. And there, what do? Max or mean, depending on the problem. Like in our case, it's a maximization of the profit. But in other case, it could be other problem statement also. Suppose, you know, CX, whether C is nothing but the cost structure, the representative of cost structure or the profit structure is a vector, and X are nothing but the variables. Say, you know, X and say CN. So this is called, you know, variables, and these are your cost component. Subject to AX less equals to B. B are nothing but your restrictions or limits, right, constraints. So based on these constraints, we will calculate the best production, whether X, as I mentioned, it could be X1, X2, ... This X will maximize or will optimize subject to maximization or minimization of the problem and these conditions. This type of problem are called, B could be a restriction, say B could be B1, B2, ... depending on the number of conditions. And AX are nothing but your total utilization of resources put together in order to produce the number of quantity of X. So this is called the general linear programming problem. You can convert that into nonlinear programming also in case your variables are coming in a nonlinear manner. So this is the general structure of optimization. That aspects you can solve using basic solver, but here we will be using it using evolver of this particular software under the context of risk analytics. Now we'll run this particular problem under risk environment. So demand are considered as a risk now, uncertain now. You can include the conditions also as a risk parameter, like availability could have a variation, say, you know, with lower bound and the standard deviation, etc. And many other aspects also you can bring, and you can make it more practical problem. Just only one aspect I am showing there, where you can integrate the uncertainty along with the optimization problem. Just go to that risk part and don't run the simulation here now. Reduce the number of simulations, say 100, say, for the sake of, you know, running the software, other it may take time, and go to risk optimizer, model definition. Here, it is like similar like Excel solver. Here you are optimizing the problem. So which cell you want to maximize or minimize here? You want to maximize your, it's a minimization, not it's a maximize. It could be supply chain minimization, warehouse cost minimization. Here we are maximizing your production profit. After production, total profit, because selling price we have mentioned. So it's a maximization problem. Which cell you are maximizing? Your total profit. Look at total profit we have selected. So that we are going to maximize. And these are your total variable limit. Who are the variable? You can see how to add it. Just go and select this particular variables, say particular variables. You select it and you can, suppose I have added here. Suppose its upper limit say 1000, suppose, or say make it more, say 1500, and lower limit say 0, the variable. So one variable, one particular cell I have added. You can add few more variables. So say step could be any, it could be with 5 interval step, whatever you want, right? Whatever you want. So as per the data, let me put so that we can run it. You can make it integer, variable could be integer, which will take only integer variable. It can be any continuous version from 0 to say thousands or 2000. It could be discrete with five step increment of your production quantity. Whatever you want, you can put it. Suppose another variable I would like to add. Suppose this variable I would like to add, this one, right? Click this and put the lower bound, say 0, and the upper bound could be, say, 2000, if you want to put. So this way you can add all the conditions, right? Here I have dragged, since we have kept all them in the same row, so you have dragged all the data and I have kept the lower bound and upper bound. If you wish, you can reduce the lower bound, upper bound also, say. And now come to the conditions. we have only these three conditions. If in your practical problem you have more conditions, you can add that also. How to add that condition? You can delete the data also. So suppose these conditions, where is condition? These conditions, right? This condition should be less than, greater than, equal, depending on the situation. Here it is less equals to, what is the upper bound of that assembly line? This one. Done. So here I have added one more conditions, but earlier if you drag all three, like, you know, I can show you, if you drag all three conditions, you can also in a single instance, you can include all them. All are less equals to, in practical problem it might be some may be less than conditions, some may be greater equals to conditions, some may be equality conditions. So you have to, you know, check all this. So we have added all of them, but no need to repeat all them. If you don't include them like this, suppose in a complex problem you have so many conditions and later you realize that this condition is becoming redundant or not required to include, and I want to see the variation and the hot-if analysis. So you can delete them also. You can just, no need to delete, just, you know, click, unclick them. Your only, if you click the particular row or, you know, condition and the variables, only they will come in active. Rather, rest of them will not be active in your optimization process. What the mistake I have done here is that, you know, same data sets I have kept once again. But if you have more different conditions, you can include that actually. Different condition you can include and you don't need to delete all them. Right, you know, like the way you condition, maybe it is because of range. So the variable range, so therefore it is creating problem. But look at here, in the condition, like, you know, I feel that if I don't click this, still it will work. Look at it is working now. So here you can come back again. So here, you know, in case you have many conditions, maybe it is because of range, you cannot change different range of the variable. So therefore you need to keep for each of them, one by one you can put the range, or all put together you can keep a range. But for conditions, constraints, you can add constant, you can delete, or you don't need to delete all, just unclick it. So this way you can define your data entry to the evolver. Check how many iterations you want to do, trials, maybe reduce it to 100 now, so that we can save the time. And then go to here. Again, now don't run your simulation here, start the optimization here. Because in this case, you will be doing optimization as well as the simulation. In every iteration of your simulation, you will generate different demand, uncertain demand, and you will get the optimization output. It is going on, it will come, you will get to know. So both will be going on in this particular case of optimization under risk. So here optimization is also going on, as well as like the LP optimization I have shown you. Using solver, evolver here, as well as the uncertainty has been also integrated to your optimization solver system. So this is more practical in reality actually. This type of problem, if you can develop with a better understanding, with a better application mode, probably you will be able to handle different case study of optimization of real practical problem or cases using this particular software. Here risk part can also be added to the system. Here you can see your total profit risk optimizer you have used, which is nothing but, you know, the optimization of your total profit of your system as subject to the uncertain conditions and the uncertain demand. And here you also, you can see the mean value, maximum, standard deviation, and all these things you can see, lower bound, upper bound, and all this analysis also you can do. You can see your tornado graph, scatter plot, which demand are of the product are making. Only demands we have considered uncertain, but in other practical cases you can consider different other parameters also, which can be also uncertain or risk parameter. In that case you can see the impact of that particular parameter, uncertain parameter, to your total profit. Here you can see, you know, model 4 has the more variation, so it will have a maximum impact to your total profit. So this type of analysis we have shown earlier. So you can see the overall, you know, analysis of this particular application of risk analytics, where you are using the optimization of your entire supply chain or the manufacturing system, at the same time your production planning system, at the same time you are integrating the uncertainty to the data. So this type of aspects can also be addressed through the risk analytics of simulation version of software. So these are the couple of applications that we intended to illustrate through this module of simulation and risk analytics. There are many more applications which you can, you know, illustrate, or you may get insights of them by, you know, downloading the different case application through the software. If you download the 14-day trial version, you may get many case application, whether it's a insurance industry, banking industry, supply chain industry, or, you know, logistic case applications, marketing application also. So many applications you will be able to get through this case examples from the software, and you can illustrate. They have the solution also. So solution, analytics, as well as the simulation part. all put together, you can do predictive analytics, you can do prescriptive analytics also. Like for this example, you can think this particular last example, product mix problem. Here we have done the prescription, then optimization as well as the prediction also. Like demand are uncertain, what could be expected total profit, demand planning, and the production planning. The expected production planning we are doing well in advance, as well as the expected prediction also with confidence interval, and you are incorporating the risk part into your model. So, you know, this particular module would help you to address practical problem on the risk analytics as well as Monte Carlo simulations. So I believe you understood the entire aspects of Monte Carlo simulation. Look at in each and every application, couple of applications I have discussed, right? In each and every applications, you could see that the background study is simulation. When you are integrating the uncertainty or risk part of any parameter of any particular problem, you are generating different, you are not taking the average value. You are actually generating in every instances of your iteration of simulation, you are generating different input of that particular parameter or variable. And accordingly, you are taking a decision of your output system. Like here, your total profit is not a fixed, because you have hundreds of simulation, like, you know, iterative values of your simulation. And then from there, you are taking mean, variance, standard deviation, kurtosis, skewness, lower bound, upper bound, confidence interval, all are with you. Tornado graph, who is making maximum impact to your output. That analysis also you are able to do through this particular analytics software of risk modeling. So this could be integrated aspects of, you know, predictive modeling as well as, you know, business forecasting. So we thought of covering this particular software also as a part of your simulation modeling under risk analytics. So with that, as I mentioned, there is no limit for this illustration of this particular software with different case applications. I leave it to you to practice different problem at home and, you know, get more confidence in understanding the risk analytics part through this particular decision tool suite software. And you can make different, you know, many statistical analysis also can be done. Decision tree, like in predictive modeling, can also be done through this particular software, and you may get more insights of it with practical case applications. With that, let us conclude this particular module of risk analytics of Monte Carlo simulation and a part of business forecasting. Thank you.